Well, good morning.
Good morning. I like it. It's good to be here this morning, right? Let's pray. Lord, we thank you for this morning. We thank you for this amazing weather. Lord, you bless us so much. And you've blessed us, Lord, with this church, with this body, with this this family, Lord, of believers. We pray that this morning you would pour out your spirit and your sons and your daughters, Lord, you would enter here into their midst. Your spirit would just cover us, Lord, and rapture us. We're here for you and for you alone. So be glorified, be honored as we praise you, as we worship you. Lord, as we give you all the glory that's due your holy name. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. If you're able, let's go ahead and stand for this first song.
Gathered in your name, calling out to you. Your glory like a fire, awakening desire, will burn our hearts with truth. You're the reason we're here. You're the reason we're singing. Open up the heavens, we want to see you.
Show us your power. Show us
Father, thank you for this beautiful day that we can gather here and sing praises to you, Lord. Would you be glorified in this place and everything that goes on here, that, Lord, you would be, your name would be lifted up on high. Thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen. 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 You can all be seated. Well, welcome, everyone. Good morning. It's good to be back here. We've got a few announcements today. Tomorrow, April 29th, is a work day here at the church at 9 a.m. I'll be cleaning out the flower beds and kind of prettying up the backyard, getting ready for the spring and summer season. A good way to kind of tithe with your time and your efforts. So come on out tomorrow at 9 a.m. to help out with that. May 2nd is the National Day of Prayer meeting here at the church at 11 a.m. Also, May 5th. Is going to be a worship and communion service at 6 p.m. That's going to be next Sunday evening. And coming up later in the month of May, May 19th, is a barbecue potluck and fellowship coming up after that's going to be after the second service on Sunday. There's a sign up on the counter for that so they can kind of get an idea of planning for food and whatnot. Also in May 25th, is the men's FMO breakfast. There's sign-ups on the counter for that. And later on in the summer, a couple camps coming up. The Janesville Bible Camp is June 10th, and there's information in registration and forms and the information for that out on the counter. And also in June 13th to 17th, is Family Camp up at Eagle Lake, and there's more information to follow for that. But try to cut out some time for that. I know that's awesome. We get to go to that, and that's a total blessing. At this time, I'd like to invite Grace up, that she's going to give an update on Pastor Mike.
Thank you, everybody, for praying. He's doing really good. Well, spiritually, he's doing really good. The trip is really amazing. They've been doing children's outreaches and had crazy responses. He says they drive out into the middle of nowhere. I mean, literally, there's nothing. And then all of a sudden, you come across this tiny little village, and there's a church, and 150 people go. They have one church that had like 500 people attending. I'm thinking, you know, these little tiny, but they also have house churches, and they like gather in one room and cram 30 people into like the size of the children's room, so, or like the radio room. I mean, they all cram into these tiny little rooms to worship the Lord. They love the Lord. It's awesome. And then they've done the children's thing, and the whole point of the children's thing is to, ostensibly, it's to teach them hygiene. They learn how to brush their teeth. They learn how to wash their hands, how to take care of themselves, and they also give them information on human trafficking, because it's a big business in Nepal. It's so poor. He said the whole country is just so poor. It's like driving through Tijuana everywhere you go. And so these people come in and offer these parents opportunities for their children to learn a career, learn a business, learn something, and if they spend them with these people, that they would give them opportunity somewhere else. And generally, they're sold into slavery. They go to Pakistan, they go to India, they go wherever, and they're not heard from again. So they're educating the parents, they're educating the children, and then they do show the Jesus film in their language. I'm not gonna say where they're at, because, you know. And the persecution is increasing. They did arrest, I sent to the prayer team, but they did arrest an American. He was deported. They did arrest a couple of Japanese, I believe, missionaries. They're in prison. They were sentenced to 10 years for evangelizing, just for sharing their faith. So it's increasing. It's mostly Buddhist, but it's becoming more and more Muslim too. So it's just become this crazy mix. But keep praying for them. they are, two of the team are really sick. Mike got sick, and Gan, the man that spoke here that's led the team, they're both very, very sick. The other two team members are okay so far, but right now is their night, their evening, so they're going to sleep. When they wake up, they've got like a 15-hour drive, so they're it's pretty miserable. So just keep them in prayer, and we'll see what the Lord's going to do. He's supposed to be back Monday. He lands Monday evening. So I'll keep you posted. I've been sending out updates on the prayer thing, and I would show you videos, but I can't. So it's really cool. Thank you.
Thank you.
our prayer that you would be our vision. Lord, you would be the thing that we focused on. You would be the light that guides us. God, we pray that you would captivate us. You would hold every ounce of direction that we have. Lord, that our hearts would be longing to seek you, to seek your word. We can only do that, Lord, with your strength, with your power, with your guidance. Lord, with your spirit. So pour out your spirit on your people. Lord, on your children. Draw us into your presence. Lord, you have our attention. Lord, you have our attention. Every eye is fixed on you. Burn away every distraction so you can come and move. We won't hesitate.
Right here, right now, we trust you, our friend.
Father, right here, right now, Lord, we want to seek you. That's our prayer, Lord, that we want to worship you and praise you. And we want to thank you, Lord. Heavenly Father, we pray for open hearts, Lord, and soft hearts to receive your word. Lord, would you clear the distractions from our mind and our lives, Lord, that we can just spend this time focusing on you and your word. Would you instruct us and guide us by your Holy Spirit? Father, pour your spirit out upon this place and may you just be glorified and honored in everything that we do here. We thank you for this time, and we give it up to you, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen. Why doesn't everybody turn around and greet one another? Right. I'd like to invite the children up so we can pray over them as we send them off to Sunday school. It's just the lower grade this morning, if I understand that right, just the younger kids. So if there are any kids that are going off to Sunday school, come on up. Father, what a blessing it is, Lord, that we get to pour into these children. We thank you for them. And Lord, we lift them up. And we just ask your blessing to be upon them, Lord, and upon the teachers that are instructing them this morning. Would you just grow them into mighty men and women of valor, Lord, that just seek to be used by you. We thank you for them, Lord, and we lift them up this time. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Good morning and welcome, everyone. As many of you know, my family has moved to Reno about a year and a half ago, but it's been a total blessing there. We've gotten plugged in at Calvary Chapel Reno Sparks, and so this morning I'd like to welcome one of our pastors from Reno. Pastor Andrew, would you come on up? He's going to be teaching this morning. So, God bless you.
Thank you. Well, good morning, everyone. It's truly an honor and privilege to be here with you guys. I was even honored that Pastor Mike would even ask me to fill in for him today. So we've been here since yesterday, and just within that span of time, you guys have made it a real delight for me and my family to be here with you guys. So appreciate it, and we love you guys. But this morning, if you guys have your Bibles with you, if you can, turn to the book of Romans chapter 13, and we are going to be looking at verses 11 through verse 14. Just a couple of verses, but we're going to really expound on them. But Romans chapter 13, verses 11 through verse 14. And I've entitled this message, Knowing the Time. And before you think I was clever enough to come up with that on my own, I actually wasn't. Those very words are mentioned in the Bible, and you'll see that very shortly. But as you find your way there, I'm going to open up in prayer. So, Father, we just thank you again for this time, Lord. We're excited to be here in your presence this morning. And as our brother mentioned, Lord, I just ask that you would clear our mind of all distractions, God, and that you would give us all ears to hear what your Spirit has to say through the ministry of your word, Lord. So would you move me out of the way and let your Spirit work mightily, Lord, for your honor and for your glory. And we thank you ahead of time for your faithfulness, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, well now, the book of Romans, this letter that we're going to be looking at this morning, is a very fascinating and wonderful letter, especially because of the impact that this letter specifically has had in the lives of many believers. You know, it's been said that countless men and women of the faith throughout the history of the church have actually singled out the book of Romans, this very letter, as being the weapon that God graciously used to bring about their surrender to Christ. Because when you read this letter, you know, one of the things that you quickly find out is that Paul gives one of the clearest presentations of the gospel in this epistle, that you and I are saved by the grace of God through faith in Jesus Christ, and that eternal life is nothing that we can work or earn contrary to popular belief and the common thinking of this world, but rather eternal life is a free gift given to anyone who would call upon the name of Jesus Christ. And that's why the gospel message is so amazing, because it's for anyone and for anyone. But that's also the reason why many people consider the book of Romans to be the greatest book in the New Testament. And if you've read the letter, you probably would agree with that. But now in the section that we're going to be looking at this morning, one of the things that we're going to see is that the scriptures are not only going to call our attention as believers to understand the times that we're living in, which is important, but also what our response should be as believers to the times in which we're living in. You know, it's never good to have all of this information without having application, right? The two always go hand in hand, and that's what we're going to see in our text today. And so if you're there in Romans chapter 13, we're going to read verses 11 through verse 14. And so if you're able to, please stand for the reading of God's word. And so Paul, through inspiration of the Spirit, says in verse 11, "And do this, knowing the time, that it is now high time to awake out of sleep. For now our salvation is nearer than when we first believed. The night is far spent, the day is at hand. Therefore, let us cast off the works of darkness, and let us put on the armor of light. Let us walk properly as in the day, not in revelry and drunkenness, not in lewdness and lust, not in strife and envy, but put on the Lord Jesus Christ and make no provision for the flesh to fulfill its lust." Amen? You guys may be seated. But as you can see from our text this morning, we got some pretty powerful verses that we're going to be covering. But as we get started, one of the things I want you guys to notice is how Paul begins this section. If you look back at verse 11, he says, "And do this knowing the time." And I like that. You know, as believers, you and I are called to know the time, right? To know what time it is, to know and understand the days in which we're living in. But a question that we can ask ourselves right off the bat as we get started this morning is, do we know what time it is, right? And do we understand the days in which we're living in, that we are in the last days, and that our Lord Jesus Christ could come back for us at any time, because his return is imminent, meaning it can happen at any moment. The rapture can take place literally at any time, and we'll talk more about that in a couple of minutes. But you know, when you take a real good look at our world today and everything that's going on, and especially at the rapid rate in which things are happening today, you know, for some people it's a little overwhelming, and rightly so, but yet it's pretty clear that things are heating up in the world today. There's a lot of changes that are going on. More and more is happening, and so much so that not even the media is able to keep up with everything that's going on, right? I mean, as much as they're trying, they can't. It's just impossible. That's how quickly times are changing. If you guys remember, It was not too long ago that abortion in this very nation of ours was once considered illegal, right? You just couldn't do it. In the early 1900s, it was considered a felony in every single state. But yet now, it's legal, and now you can actually have as many abortions as you want. But if you've been keeping up with the news, you probably know this by now, but they're even trying to pass some laws to allow for full-term abortions, which means that a mom can abort her baby right up to the point where the baby fully exits the womb. Now, if you ask me, that's murder, and yet these are the types of laws that are trying to be passed today, the slaughtering of innocent children. But if you guys also remember, it wasn't up until 4 years ago that same-sex marriages were also considered illegal in this nation, and yet now it's the law of the land, right? It's now legal in all 50 states. This world is trying to redefine the biblical definition of marriage, which God said from the very beginning is between one man and one woman. Amen? And I'm going to go with what God has to say, because God is the one who instituted marriage, and he knows how it operates best, and he said it's between one man and one woman. But again, times are changing, and these are just two of the many examples of some of the things that we see taking place just in this nation alone. We're not talking about the Middle East, which is a different topic for a different day, but I give you all of that information, I tell you all of that to say this, and that is that this world is getting worse and worse with each passing day. Have you guys noticed that? And maybe for those of you who haven't noticed, just turn on the news, watch for about 5 minutes, and you'll start to get depressed because of all these catastrophic events that we see taking place in our world. Just last Sunday, on Resurrection Sunday, you probably heard about this, about the bombings that took place in Sri Lanka. You know, you had several suicide bombers that went into various churches as well as luxurious hotels, and they just blew themselves up, killing a total at the time. On Sunday, it was reported about 200 people, but the last report I saw, the death toll now rose to 350-plus individuals. And there was also another incident that occurred in San Diego at a church. This one kind of went under the radar, but basically we're told that this lady came and brandished a handgun in front of everyone while holding a little toddler in her hand, claiming that she was going to blow up the church. But praise God, they were able to disarm her and then tackle her to the ground. But yet these kinds of incidents are now becoming the norm in our society in this day and age. And as a student of the word, I find this interesting because, you know, we are starting to see an increase in wickedness and violence in this day and age that we're living in, which actually describe the same conditions that were going on in the days of Noah. I mean, if you look back at Genesis chapter 6, you can see these were two of the very conditions that were taking place in his day right before judgment fell on his people, and yet we're starting to see these same things taking place in our own day. But now, as you take a step back from everything that's going on in the world today, from these mass shootings to these earthquakes that are happening in diverse places, I honestly believe that the Lord is trying to wake us up to let us know that his return is near, because as we see these events unfolding right before our own eyes, I mean, you can almost sense the lateness of the hour, right? And the nearness of our Lord's return, that Jesus is coming soon. And it was our Lord himself who said to his disciples in Luke chapter 21, verse 28, now when these things begin to happen, that is when you start to see the signs of the end times, he said, look up and lift up your heads because your redemption draws near. You know, as the church, as the body of Christ, we've never been closer to the Lord's return, to the rapture of the church, than we are today, this very morning. And every single day, we are getting closer and closer and closer to that day. And as many of you know, there is nothing that needs to happen in order for the rapture to take place, right? Because it's a signless event. And when I say it's a signless event, what I mean by that is that there's no sign, prophecy, or special event that needs to take place around the world in order for the rapture to happen. It can literally happen at any moment, and when the rapture does take place, it's gonna happen just that fast. As Paul said to the church in Corinth, in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, so we have to be ready, because Jesus Christ could come back for his church at any time. And Wouldn't it be great if it happened today? Right after the service, he sounds a trumpet. We're taken out of here. But now, if you were to ask the Apostle John the question, what time is it? He would tell you in 1 John chapter 2, verse 18, little children, it is the last hour. And as you have heard that the Antichrist is coming, even now many Antichrists have come by which we know that it is the last hour. Now, John says it's the last hour, and he said that close to 2,000 years ago. How much closer do you think we are today, right? I mean, if John said it's the last hour and he said that back in the first century, then that means we're probably in the final minutes, if not the final seconds of church history. So time is running out. And so again, you and I as believers are called to know the time, to know and understand the days in which we're living in. But again, if you look at verse 11, Paul says, and do this knowing the time or understanding what time it is, that now it is high time to awake out of sleep. And as I was reading this verse over and over again this week, I couldn't help but to notice how Paul says that now is the time, right? And now meaning not later, not tomorrow, not 3 years from today or 10 years in the future, but he says now. Now is the time. You know, I think that there's this tendency among many people in the world today, but even in the church, who can begin to have this mentality that we have all of this time in the world to do whatever it is that we want to do, because they say life is going to go on as usual. We still have a lot of time left. But in reality, that's just not the case. Time is limited, and it's shorter than any of us think, and that's Paul's point here to the Romans. And that's why to the church at Ephesus, Paul would say to the believers there in Ephesians chapter 5, verse 18, he told them, see then that you walk circumspectly, not as fools, but as wise, redeeming the time. And then he tells us why, because the days are evil. I mean, doesn't that not describe our generation or what? These days are evil. We're seeing a manifestation of evil more than ever before. And because of that, Paul's exhortation to the believers in his day, but even today, is that in these last days, we ought to be redeeming the time, meaning we ought to be buying it back, not wasting the precious time that God has given us as believers. You see, knowing that our time is short on this earth and that our Lord could come back at any time, essentially what Paul is telling us is that we shouldn't be using the time to live like the rest of the world, to get caught up in the ways of the world, but rather we should be seeking to live for the Lord and looking for opportunities of how we could serve him and serve each other, his people, which I know many of you are already doing. And my encouragement to you this morning is to keep up that good work, to continue to serve the Lord, to continue to be faithful with everything that God has entrusted you with, from your marriages to your ministries. Because, you know, one day we are going to receive a reward for all of our labor, all of our toil at the judgment seat of Christ. And when Jesus says to us individually, well done, good and faithful servant, on that day it's all going to be worth it. All of our toil, all of our labor. And, you know, I also appreciate what Jesus said. He said, occupy till I come. In other words, do business till I come. Be about the Father's business as we wait for the Lord's return. Amen? But now when Paul again says to the Romans that now it is high time to awake out of sleep, what Paul is doing here is he's actually inviting the church to wake up, believe it or not. Because unfortunately, there are some believers in the church today who are asleep, who are clueless to the times that we're living in. You know, they're oblivious to everything that's going on around them. And that was actually the case of the religious leaders in Jesus' day. You know, when you look back at Matthew chapter 16, Jesus actually chastised the religious leaders of his day for not knowing the signs of the times. You see, these people could tell you whether it was going to rain that day, whether it was going to be stormy, whether the sun was going to be out, which is not too hard to do. But yet when it came to the signs of the times, they had no idea what was going on. You see, had they understood the days in which they were living in, they would have known that the Messiah of Israel was right in front of them. They would have also known the very day that Jesus made his triumphal entry there in the city of Jerusalem, because that's mentioned back in Daniel chapter 9, And yet, they completely missed it because they did not know the signs of the times. And that's how a lot of believers are today. They don't know what's going on. They're not reading their Bibles. And I say this with much sorrow, but unfortunately, there are even some professing Christians who can care less about what's going on. And, you know, it's for that reason I've often wondered and even asked myself the question from time to time, how much of the church today is asleep? And when I say how much of the church today is asleep, I'm not talking about physically being asleep, but rather how much of the church today is spiritually asleep. They just don't know what's going on. They've been so caught up in the ways of this world that they've lost focus on eternity. And actually, one of our sisters mentioned that not too long ago. You know, it's easy for us, if we're honest with ourselves, to get caught up in this world, right? Where we then become complacent and let our guards down. We're just going through the routines of everyday life. But yet, according to the Apostle Paul here in our text, he is telling us that now is not the time to be doing that. Now is not the time to be letting our guards down or to become complacent, but now is the time to actually be waking up. Church, it's time to be waking up, he's saying, because Jesus Christ is coming soon. And you know, often in the scriptures, as it relates to the Lord's return, we're often told as believers that we're not to be sleeping, but are rather commanded to be watching. To the church in Thessalonica in 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 6, Paul said to them, "Therefore, let us not sleep as others do." Meaning, don't be like the rest of the world who doesn't know what's going on, who's fallen asleep, who's more focused on the here and now rather than eternity. He says, don't be like them. But, which is a word of contrast, he says, but let us watch and be sober. And then in Mark chapter 13, verse 35, Jesus also said to his disciples, "Watch therefore, for you do not know when the master of the house is coming, in the evening, at midnight, at the crowing of the rooster, or in the morning, lest coming suddenly he find you sleeping." And then he says, "And what I say to you, I say to all, watch." And when he says to watch, it's not a suggestion, it's actually a command. And for you Bible students and note takers, that word watch, it means to be awake or to be on the alert. And so as believers, we are to live with the constant expectation of our Lord's return, knowing that he can come back for us at any time. And, you know, it's for that reason why we should study Bible prophecy, because prophecy points us to the return of Jesus Christ. And, you know, this is unfortunate, but there's a lot of preachers and churches today who will tell you that they don't study prophecy either because A, it's irrelevant, or B, no one can understand it. But there's a Greek word for that, and that's baloney. You can understand, yeah, you can understand Bible prophecy. But I like how one preacher put it. He said that Bible prophecy wasn't made to scare us, but to prepare us, right? It's to prepare us for the return of Jesus Christ. And that's why we study the entirety of God's word from Genesis to Revelation. But again, here we see that we're commanded as believers to be watching, to be awake, and to know the time. But now the question begs, why should we be doing either one of those things? I mean, what's the importance of watching, right? What's the importance of being awake or knowing the time? Well, I'm glad you asked. Look at what Paul goes on to say. He says, "For now," and notice, now meaning not later. He says, "For now our salvation is nearer than when we first believed." Amen? That's why we ought to be knowing the time, because our salvation is now nearer than when we first believed. Again, every single day, we are getting closer and closer to the Lord's return, to the rapture of the church, when the Lord is going to take us out of this world and back to the Father's house, which the Bible says he's gone to prepare a place for us. Amen? You know, we're told in John chapter 14, I think it's right around verse 2, Jesus speaking to his disciples, he told them, "I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go to prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you to myself, that where I am," where is he at? Heaven, the Father's house, right? He says that where I am, there you may be also. And again, any single day now, the Lord is going to sound that trumpet, and beginning with the dead in Christ, they're going to rise first. And I like what one person said. He said that the reason why the dead in Christ rise first is because they're 6 feet under the ground, so they need a head start. That's not the proper interpretation, but the Bible says that the dead in Christ are going to rise first, and then we who are alive and remain will then be caught up together in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And I always love the last verse of that chapter. He says, and thus we shall always be with the Lord. You know, from that moment forward, we are always going to be with our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, for all eternity. And it's going to be awesome. But now, when Paul says that now our salvation is nearer than when we first believed, what Paul is referring to here is the consummation of our salvation. He's talking here about our glorification, which is a time where all of us are going to be taken home to be with the Lord at the rapture, and when we're going to receive new and glorified bodies. And yes, I said new and glorified bodies. You know, at the rapture, we're going to receive bodies that are now suited for heaven, but it's also the time where sin is going to be totally done away with, where we are going to finally be freed from the presence of sin. And I don't know about you guys, but I am sure looking forward to that day where I don't have to battle with my sinful nature anymore, you know, because it's a constant struggle with all of us. I constantly have to say no to the flesh and yes to the spirit, just like all of us, everyone here. But yet on that day, sin is going to be a thing of the past, and that's because of the hope that we have in Jesus Christ. But again, knowing that that day is quickly approaching us, Paul's inviting the church to wake up out of their sleep, to wake up out of their spiritual slumber. And a question that we can ask ourselves this morning as we look at what Paul is saying here is, are we like those that he's describing? Are we asleep? Have we fallen asleep at the wheel of our Christian walk? Have we become spiritually apathetic to the times in which we're living in? Or are we awake and are we looking forward to the return of Jesus Christ? And does our life reflect that? You see, because knowing that the Lord could come back at any moment, that reality should have an impact on the way that we live on a daily basis. It's even going to affect how we spend the rest of our time here on this earth. And if you guys remember, it was the Apostle John in 1 John 3:3 who said this, and everyone who has this hope in him, and in the context it's referring to the hope of Jesus' return, he says, and everyone who has this hope in him purifies himself just as he is pure. In other words, if we honestly believe that Jesus could come back at any moment, even today, that reality is going to have an impact on our life to the point where we're going to take the necessary steps towards purifying ourselves, towards living a holy life before the Lord, saying yes to the Lord, yes to the Spirit, and no to the flesh. Does that make sense, guys? And then it was also in 1 John chapter 2, verse 28, where he said, and now, little children, abide in him, that when he appears, and I like how the Bible says when he appears, because it's not a question of if he's going to appear, right? It's a matter of when. He's definitely coming back. But he says, and now, little children, abide in him, that when he appears, we may have confidence and not be ashamed before him at his coming. And so we want to be found abiding in him when he returns. But now look at what Paul goes on to say in verse 12. He tells the Romans, the night is far spent and the day is at hand. And the night that Paul's referring to here is the night of human darkness. It's this present evil age in which we're currently a part of, which has also been called man's day, which is full of sin and rebellion, and where Satan is currently having his way in this world. You know, the Bible calls Satan the god of this age, right? Because he's the one who's influencing this world, and not for good, but rather for evil. And we're seeing that manifested on a daily basis everywhere, from the schools to the government to Congress, everywhere. But then on the other hand, when Paul says that the day is at hand, the day that Paul's referring to here is the return of Jesus Christ and his rule and reign upon this earth, where he's going to set up his kingdom for 1,000 years during the millennium. But it's also the time where you and I are going to come back with Jesus at his second coming and reign with him during that 1,000-year period of time. The Bible tells us in Revelation chapter 20 that we are going to be priests of God and of Christ. But now, concerning this verse, I like what one commentator mentioned. He said, quote, "The nighttime of world history," which is referring to this present time, "the night of world history will soon give way to the daylight of Christ's glorious kingdom." And I like that. You know, that day is coming. The kingdom age is coming, where our Lord Jesus Christ is going to rule over all the nations of the world. And we're told that during the millennium, it's going to be a time of true peace on this earth. And not like the peace that this world so often tries to offer, which is a false peace and one that's usually short-lived. But during the millennium, it's going to be a time of true peace on this earth. And that's because the Prince of Peace, Jesus Christ, is going to be the one ruling on this earth. Amen? So you know what that tells me? No more corrupt government. Man's day is coming to an end. But again, Paul says, the night is far spent, the day is at hand. But now, realizing that there's not much time left in this age, Paul goes on to say in verse 12, therefore, which is a word of application, knowing that time is running out, he says, therefore, let us, and who's the us here? Yeah, believers, right? Notice he says, therefore, let us cast off the works of darkness and let us put on the armor of light. Now, Paul's going to use that phrase, let us, which is a word of action, three different times just within these two verses to describe what believers ought to be doing in light of the soon return of Jesus Christ. And by the way, all of these actions are all conscious decisions that we on our own have to make. And so what that means is that this is something I can't do for you, and likewise, this is something you can't do for me. So there's effort on our part. But notice the first thing that Paul says that we as believers ought to be doing. He says that we're to cast off the works of darkness. And the works of darkness, they speak about all of our sinful habits. It's those things that we like to do when no one else is watching. It's the secret things that we don't want anyone else to know about or even get caught doing, lest we be exposed for those things. And when Paul says to us that we're to cast those works off, the picture is of a man taking off his filthy garments, just stripping them to the ground. You know, just like after a long day at work, we're ready to go home, take off our clothes, and hit the shower, right? Take off those dirty clothes because they're sweaty and they stink, some more than others. But the same thing is true about sin. Sin, when it comes down to it, it stinks and it breaks our fellowship with God. And that's why Paul says we're to cast off those works of darkness, knowing that Jesus Christ could come back for us at any time. We don't want to get caught up in our own sinful habits and our old sinful nature, submitting ourselves to the flesh. Does that make sense, guys? But now, in contrast to casting off the works of darkness, Paul goes on to say that we as believers are to also put on the armor of light. And the reason why we're to put on the armor of light is because we are in a spiritual battle. How many of you believe that? Everyone, right? We're in a war. And Paul made that clear when writing to the church in Ephesus. In Ephesians chapter 6, verse 12, he said to the believers there, "For we do not wrestle against flesh and blood." In other words, our battle is not against human opponents. He says, "But against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this age, against spiritual hosts of wickedness in heavenly places." You see, our battle is not against fellow human beings. It's not against the Democrats or against the liberals or against those who promote socialism, though it so often seems that way. But rather, what Paul is saying here is that our battle is against all of these demonic forces who so often work through human instruments. And because of that, Paul says we need to be putting on our armor. You see, armor is made for warfare. And the purpose of putting armor on is to protect us. You say, protect us from what? I didn't know we were under attack. Well, you see, the moment that you and I said yes to Jesus, the moment that we became believers, we made an enemy. And his name's the devil, right? Satan. And he seeks our demise every single day. The Bible tells us that our adversary, the devil, that he walks about like a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour. And, you know, just like a vicious lion, he's always looking to attack us. He's always looking to deceive us, to tempt us. to discourage us and even to drag us out of fellowship with God, and not to compliment him, but he's very good at what he does. He's been doing it for thousands of years. But again, Paul's making the point that we are in a spiritual battle. To the church in Ephesus, Paul also said in Ephesians 6, verse 11, put on the whole armor of God. And then he tells us why. So that you may be able to stand against the wiles or the methods of the devil. You see, the devil has different methods or strategies of trying to take you and me down. And if one tactic doesn't work, you better believe he's going to try to use a different one. If he can't deceive you through the lust of the eyes, he's going to use the lust of the flesh. And if that doesn't work, he's going to use the pride of life. But again, that's the reason why Paul says we need to be putting on the armor of light. Or as another translation puts it, put on the shining armor of right living, which is really the idea here. We want to be living holy lives in these last days as we wait for the Lord's return. Does that make sense, guys? But again, as believers, the first thing Paul says that we're to do is cast off the works of darkness, which means cast off all of your sinful habits, all of those things which are going to hinder you from running this race of faith. But then secondly, he also says that we're to put on the armor of light, or the armor of right living. And remember, the incentive is that all of these things are to be done in light of the soon return of Jesus Christ. And so the question I ask you this morning is, what kind of clothes do you want to be wearing when Jesus comes back? Do you want to be wearing clothes of darkness or clothes of light? Do you want to be living a sinful lifestyle caught up in the ways of this world, or do you want to be living a holy life before the Lord when he returns? Again, it's a daily decision that we have to make. But now Paul's going to tell us the third thing that we're to be doing in light of his return. He says in verse 13, let us walk properly as in the day. And if you've been noticing the progression, he's told us three different things already. He says we're to cast off, put on, and now walk. He says we're to cast off the works of darkness, we're to put on the armor of light, but now he says we're to walk properly. And that's a perfect picture of sanctification. You know, every single day as believers, we are becoming more and more like our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. The more we've been walking with the Lord, the more time we're spending with the Lord, we're becoming more like Jesus. And that's actually God's will for your life and for mine. But the third thing he says here that we're to do is to walk properly. And to walk properly means to live our lives in such a way that is pleasing to God. And it's actually describing an outward lifestyle that's consistent with our inner nature in Christ. And so essentially what Paul is saying here is that we're not to walk like the rest of the world who's living in darkness, who again is more focused on the here and now rather than eternity. But now in the second half of verse 13, Paul is going to list a number of specific sins which describe the works of darkness which believers are not to be engaging in. And there are actually three pairs of these sins. Here's the first pair. He says, not in revelry and drunkenness. And that word revelry is a word that came to describe all types of wild partying. It also includes sexual orgies and even rioting. But the picture here is of drunken people who are partying out in the streets late at night while engaging in all types of immoral behavior. Now, as a former police officer, just like Pastor Mike, I know that comes as a surprise to many people when I say that, but one of the things I used to see on a weekly basis is what Paul's describing here. People who would live for the weekend, and you probably know people like that. They throw all their money at the bars, on evil lifestyles. Specifically, I used to see this because we were located in downtown where my jurisdiction was. But I used to see people, you know, getting into all these fights because of all this consumption of alcohol, which would then lead them to get arrested, which would then lead them, you know, to engage in all these sexual and moral behaviors. And that's the kind of person that Paul is talking about here. But I want to remind you this morning, who is Paul talking to here? Is he talking to believers or to unbelievers? To believers, right? And so in the context, he is talking to believers. And so what Paul is saying here, the application, is if you're caught up in this type of lifestyle, Paul says you need to repent of it. Cast off that work of darkness. But then the second sin he says we're to cast off is drunkenness, which is pretty self-explanatory. It's describing those who are given over to habitual intoxication. And, you know, we're also told in the Bible that those who continue in that type of lifestyle will not inherit the kingdom of God. Paul also said, don't be deceived by that. But then the second pair of sins we're to cast off, he says, not in lewdness and lust. And that word lewdness, which is also translated as chambering, if you have a King James version of the Bible, it's actually an old English word, because the chamber was the bed or the bedroom, but the word chambering is a word that refers to going to bed with someone else other than your wife. But eventually that word came to describe all kinds of sexual immorality outside of marriage. And so again, Paul speaking to the believers says, if you're caught up in this type of lifestyle, you need to repent of it. Knowing that Jesus is coming soon, you don't want to be caught living that type of lifestyle. He says, cast it off. And then Paul says that we're also to cast off lust, which is also translated as licentiousness or wantonness. And I like how Pastor Chuck Smith described this word. He said this, quote, it's the ugliest word in the Greek language. This is when a person has not just gone to the bottom, but below. It's not just a person who does evil, vile things, but it's a person who boasts of the evil, vile things and takes pride in how evil or how vile he was. In other words, it's describing a person who has given themselves over to immorality and takes pride in what they're doing. It's almost like, you know, they're puffed up about the sin that they're doing. It's the absence of restraint. But then finally, the third pair of sins Paul says we're to cast off, he says, not in strife and envy. And that word strife or quarreling, it refers to persistent contentions, and it describes a person who's always engaging in petty disagreements. And you guys probably know people like that. You know, they're always ready to disagree with you about anything and about everything, and they'll fight to have their way, you know, no matter how much they hurt your feelings. And really, it all stems from pride. But Paul says, if you're engaging in that, cast off that work of darkness. And then finally, he says, and that we're to cast off envy, which is a passion to do what is wrong, and it's also a desire to deprive another person of what he has. And you know, these are just six sins that Paul lists here. If you look at Galatians chapter 5 or Ephesians chapter 5, there are other sins that Paul says that we're to be casting off. But Paul's point here is that the reason why we're to be turning away from all of our sinful habits, turning away from the works of darkness, is because, again, the night is far spent and the day is at hand. Our Lord Jesus Christ is coming soon. And now look at verse 14, and we'll end here. Paul says, but, which is a word of contrast, he says, but put on the Lord Jesus Christ and make no provision for the flesh to fulfill its lusts. And so instead of engaging in all of the works of darkness, getting caught up in our old sinful habits, living like the rest of the world, going back to our old ways of living, what Paul is saying here is put on the Lord Jesus Christ. You say, what in the world does that mean? What is Paul saying here? Well, as believers, we need to clothe ourselves with Christ, with his character, with his attributes, and with his attitudes. And not only that, but we need to take Jesus everywhere we go, not just here at church, but even in our homes, right? In the workplaces, in the schools, wherever we may go. But secondly, he also says that we're not to make no provision for the flesh to fulfill its lust. And that word provision, it's an interesting word in the Greek. It means to give forethought to something or to plan ahead. And in the context, it's to give forethought or plan ahead to gratify your flesh, to gratify your old sinful nature. And so what Paul is saying here is cut the supply line of your flesh. In other words, if you know that by going to a certain place is going to cause you to sin, then don't go there, right? or if you know that by watching a certain TV program or something on the internet, it's going to cause you to develop lustful thoughts, then don't watch that. And really what Paul has been trying to say here in a nutshell is that we shouldn't be using the remainder of our time to live carelessly, but rather carefully as we wait for the Lord's return. And again, when you look at what's going on in the world today, it's abundantly clear that Christ is coming back very soon. Yes, nobody knows the day nor the hour of his return, but we can know the times and the season. And I believe that we're living in the season of his soon return. And again, Jesus says that we're to be looking up because our redemption draws near. Amen. And so the question I want to leave with everyone this morning, though, is a question I asked you earlier, is are you ready? If the Lord were to sound the trumpet today, will you be ready? That's only a question that you and the Lord know. I don't know, and I can't answer for you. But for those of you maybe who don't know the answer to that question, I want to give you guys an opportunity as we close in prayer. Amen? So let's bow our hearts. Father, we just, Lord, thank you, first of all, for your word, Lord. Thank you that you are coming soon, Lord. And thank you that your word says that all who call upon the name of Jesus Christ shall be saved. Lord, if there's anyone here today or anyone who's watching over Facebook who does not know you as Lord and Savior, God, I pray that today would be the day of salvation for them, that you would help them to see their need for Jesus, Lord, to call upon his name, Lord. And for the rest of my brothers and sisters here, Lord, I just pray, Father, that you would help us all to continue steadfastly in the faith, that as Paul said to Titus, that we would be looking for the blessed hope and the glorious appearing of our great God and Savior, Jesus Christ. Lord, we praise you this morning for your goodness, for your faithfulness, and everything that you're doing in our lives that's going to bring glory and honor to you. So we thank you for all these things, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you.
Trust in Jesus' name. Jesus' blood and righteousness.
Heavenly Father, thank you that you are the solid foundation that we can rest our hope upon. Lord God, we thank you that we can rest assured that we put our faith and trust in you, and we know that your word is true, that those who call upon your name shall be saved. We thank you for that, Lord. We look forward to your soon return. Lord God, as we are encouraged to cast off our works of darkness, we pray, Lord, that you would help us to fill the voids in our life, Lord, with works of righteousness. Heavenly Father, would you just equip us to do your will, Lord. We thank you and we praise you in Jesus' name. Amen.
The Lord bless thee,
the Lord bless thee,
and keep thee,
and keep thee.
The Lord make his face to shine upon thee, and be gracious unto thee, and be gracious unto thee. The Lord lift up his countenance,
his countenance
upon thee and give thee peace.
Amen. God bless you guys. You have a great rest of your day and a great week.